Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the product design show Expert Speak, like every Saturday. Today we have an expert, Nikhil is from Parkson's Packaging, the design studio of Parkson's Packaging called Park Design. So we requested Nikhil, who is the design head at Design Park in Parkson's, to give a talk. Nikhil, can you please come online and take over the stage? Thank you.
Sure. Okay, so good evening, everyone. Thanks for coming. Thanks for attending the talk. So what I was thinking is, first, I'll talk about what we do as a studio and what we are as a company. And once that is done, the introduction part is done, I'll present a few case studies, and hopefully all of you will find it insightful and take away something interesting from the talk. So I'll get to it. We are basically an R&D studio of a fiber-based packaging company called Parkson's Packaging, and what we do is basically we are a design and innovation unit of a packaging converter. So what is a fiber-based packaging converter? So when I'm talking about fiber-based packaging, I'm talking about paper board, and then cardboard. So this is the realm within which we work. And as for a packaging converter, what does a packaging converter do is basically, how paper is made, right? So once we get like sheets of paper or rolls of paper, what we do is we convert it by applying, say, many processes, post-printing and pre-printing processes, the printing process itself. And once that is done, what you see in the supermarkets, like when you go to the supermarkets, on the shelf, the box, the paper box that you hold, the packaging that you hold, that is the end result, what we give to our clients. So we work with most of the major FMCG and liquor, and a lot of these, in many areas, we work with all of the major clients in India. Chances are, if you go to a normal supermarket, a lot of boxes, you'll find, if you turn the box and you look at the logo at the bottom, you'll see most of it has been converted by us. And so it's a very interesting and fascinating process, especially the kind of printing machines we have, a very high-end printing machines. And in fact, when we spoke to the engineers, what they said is the offset printing machines we have, they have almost as many working parts as like a space shuttle, as much as a space shuttle. So it's a very interesting and complex machine, and that is like one of the pillars of our business, And so what do you see when you go to a supermarket and you pick up a box in your hand? So of course, the graphic design, the color, the proportion is something that strikes you, first. But that is half the story. Graphic design is one part of the story, and then structural design is another part of the story. So what we do is ideally structural design. We are specializing in structural design. And let's see. I mean, what I thought is, let's go through some case studies. And once we go through some case studies, what we've done, then hopefully you guys will have an idea of what I'm talking about when I'm saying that minimum packaging and maximum experience. So packaging as a field, so packaging as a segment, packaging design, it's especially when it comes to us. Okay, I hope you guys are aware of the three different types of packaging that any product goes through. One is the primary packaging, the secondary packaging, and the tertiary packaging. So let me give an example of, say, Surf Excel detergent. You've all, you know, come across it in the market. So when I'm talking about Surf Excel detergent, the pouch that the detergent goes in, so which is like the first, you know, basis of contact, that would be like a primary packaging. So it depends on different products, you know, and then that pouch goes inside a box. If you've seen Surf Excel Matic, so that goes inside a box. So that would be like a secondary packaging. And a tertiary packaging is ideally what that box goes into shippers. So you know those brown cardboard shipper boxes that you have that goes in containers. So that would be tertiary packaging. So most of the projects that we come across is mostly, you know, secondary packaging as a value addition. And you know, obviously right now, look, if you look at the trend that's going, people are talking about reducing packaging, becoming more conscious, you know, of what we consume and how we consume. So as a studio, you know, we've always been conscious that if there is something that we can reduce and we can, you know, eliminate in terms of material, we propose that solution. So it's on the basis of that most of our designs are made. And so I hope some of the case studies that I will show you will illustrate what role that structural packaging plays, and hopefully you'll learn something from this. And okay, let me talk a little bit about the studio. So we are a team of industrial designers and packaging technologists. Right now, packaging engineers also. And right now how we work is in a very cross-functional way. So there's a lot of cross-learning inside. So there is no such, differentiation as in like only the designers will do the design work and the engineers will do the engineering work. So whenever you get a project, all of us contribute to get like the best result possible. And the advantage of such a cross-functional team is that we learn each other's tools and skills and ultimately provide the best result that is possible. That is what I believe in. Okay. So I'll just start share some of my case studies. Okay. Can everyone see my screen?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, I'll talk about a very interesting project that is like also very close to what we do in day-to-day life. It's for Nestle Maggi. So I'm sure, like, especially since most of your students also, we've all made Maggi. And when this project came to us, what we realized is when you buy a packet of Maggi, what will actually, you know, put you off, right? For me, one is like, if most of the noodles inside the packet, the dried noodles, or, you know, if that is already broken, that is something which I would, you know, really hate. And if I find like a broken, such a damage, for me, that is like damage, even though on the exterior, the print and the packet is fine. For me, if I find like the contents in the interior are broken, that is for me something that ruins the experience. So when Nestle came to us, So if you remember, they had suffered like a bit of a setback in between. And what they decided to do when Maggi was returning, they decided to launch 4 new flavors for their Maggi brand. And the format that they chose was like three packets of each of the 4 flavors in 12 and a total of 12 packs. So that's like a lot of SKUs. So the when we did the research, like what would I, when I'm going to especially since there is no contact with the shelves, so it's more important for e-commerce, especially in e-commerce packaging, that the consumer receives the best experience. So only then you have a chance of them buying back. And so this was basically the challenge, was how do we, because they had so many SKUs, they had considered like a lot of, you know, plastic trays. A lot of people, I'm sure a lot of you would have, when you order from Amazon, you would have experienced like a lot of waste packaging also, you know, and that's doesn't really give a good impression. So what we did with the above insights, with the insights that we had, we decided to solve a lot of their logistic problem, and at the same time, how to retain the consumer experience. And this is the solution that we have, which is the auto partition pack. So as you can see, as per from the research that we had, we developed a brief of our own, and the brief was to develop a direct-to-consumer packaging solution, and we want to retain the experience of the pack of buying a packet of noodles, you know. And what we designed is an integrated partitioning solution. So they came to us with a lot of, you know, parts, like should we add multiple, you know, plastic trays to cushion it. So we created a solution that is like an integrated. So it's like a single structure. What you're doing is you're resolving all the functions that we have that was required when you wanted to sell it through an online channel. And so how it works is basically, as I said, the understanding the material is key in this, how the paper reacts, how the material reacts to creases and folds. And a lot of it is, you know, geometry. And that's how we created this auto partitioning system, which is like, it ships flat form. You would understand flat form is basically, we can ship it from our end to Nestle, Maggi in like so that it's easy to transport it. And once it goes to their end, it's very easy for them to assemble it. If you've seen a lot of these e-commerce, if you've been to any of these warehouses or hubs, there's not much time they have, you know, to pack things. So this was a solution they liked and was well accepted. Okay. Now I want to talk a little bit more about, so in secondary packaging, in what we do as a packaging converter, a lot of business comes from festive packaging, you know, because that is where the brands want to create like a difference between the competition and themselves. So every year, so for instance, every Diwali or say in any of these festivals or Valentine's Day, they try to come out with newer and newer stuff. And in the gifting category, one of our brief, like what we set a brief for ourselves is that what would make you retain the packaging, right? So generally, when you buy a product, especially when you buy chocolate or some kind of gifts, what we do is generally we take the product and we dispose of the packaging. So what we thought is, what would actually make you retain the packaging? And once we set this, you know, this brief for ourselves, we came up with a personalized message pack. So what the insight was that if there is an element of personalization that we can, you know, integrate into the packaging, that is something, you know, that you would retain. For instance, if you have like a handwritten personal message of a loved one, that is something that you would retain, right? Rather than it being just like a packaging with like a nice printing and printed effects, that is something which is personal to you, and that is something which you know, I know I've kept at I have received certain gifts which are personalized, and I kept those. So this was like a big success, and every year in different forms it's you know, it comes back to us. So this is the Valentine's pack, or which is a personalized message pack. So what it does, it gives the consumer the ability to send like a personalized message. You don't need to, you know, stick a thank you card to it, or it's something that is integrated within the packaging itself. So what it does, so how it works is, you buy a packet of Dairy Milk Silk, and once you buy it, you open a certain part. There is like a panel which you can open. You write your personalized message, then you close the panel, and then you gift it to the person that you really want to gift. And when they receive the gift, and when they open the chocolate, they'll see the product, you know, in line along with your handwritten message. So this was a very successful format, and not only for you know, for chocolates, we actually also commercialized it for other brands, say for like cosmetic kits, you know, and you know, some perfumes. So these are some of the areas which we were able to apply. So the insight and the idea remains the same, but you can actually apply it to any different category or any different sector. Okay, this was another fun project, which was like a, you know, a value add. If you were a 90s kid, if you're a 90s kid, you'll remember that Cadbury gems used to come in like a plastic ball, right? So what they wanted was, this time they wanted to keep the playfulness of the packaging, at the same time, you know, make it more eco-friendly. So, you know, so, and since the product itself, you know, gems is not a very high value item, so that is something they wanted to keep the packaging completely automated. So, because you can do a lot of beautiful things, you know, if you go online, you'll see a lot of beautiful things that you can do if the packaging is something which is manually formed, which something which requires a bit of, you know, craft work. So a lot of that is there, but the main challenge is to actually industrialize it, you know, to make it manufacturing friendly. So we went through a lot of iterations, and we finally achieved what they wanted. And so even if you go to YouTube, you'll see a lot of videos of kids playing with this pack, and for us that is like the biggest validation of the design. So what was the objective? The objective was to design a playable pack, so that the end user retains it. And so what we did is, we came up with like a pack with reconfigurable graphic panels. So something like a Rubik's Cube, if you remember. So what you can do is, you can, you know, flip the different panels and play the game. So it's a good level of interaction for the target market, you know. And again, it was a commercially successful design, and it really brought joy to the end consumer, which is to me, that is like the that is a success as far as our expertise is concerned. Excuse me. Okay, so this is another different level of different types of. So in the past, from what I've shown you so far, you'll see like each of these projects have different kind of challenges. Some of them are technical challenges. Some of them are value addition and end user experience. So when it comes to this project, it was more of a technical challenge. And so Cipla, the manufacturer of intravenous drug, they wanted they had this glass vials, and they were using a plastic insert, and they were seeing like a lot of, it was a very it was selling a lot, and they were experiencing transit damage of more than 30%. So that's a very significant loss for the company. And so when they came to us with a brief, they had this plastic insert, and which was not working. And so what we did is, first we started a detailed study of what is actually contributing to breaking of the vials, and we concluded that the vials will break as long as they are, because during transit the boxes endure a lot of abuse. So what we concluded that the best way to actually design this would be so that the vial itself, the glass vial itself, does not touch any of the walls of the box. So based on that, we overhauled the whole design, and we created like a very simple, we narrowed down to actually to a very simple insert, which reduced their transit loss to less than 1%. As you can see, the vials are in like a very simple, like an M sort of an insert. So what this simple plastic insert does is it protects the vials in three axes, and it suspends it, kind of suspends the vial. And again, this was like a successful ergonomic design, and was appreciated by the brand and the users as well. So for me, this is again where we achieved a very critical solution by using a very simple, by using minimal paper and minimum material. And okay, coming to the next solution. So this was for Skillmatics. Skillmatics is like what they do is they design STEM-based games, for children and adults. Okay. So this one was for like a particular game called Newton's Tree, and if you can compare, it's very similar to, it takes its inspiration from Jenga a little bit, it's a game of balance. And so while they were developing the product itself, they came to us that this is something which is going to be, displayed in Hamleys. And if you've been to like a store like Hamleys, you'll see how difficult the environment is. And for each product, each of the product is actually, calling out. And it's a very tough and competitive environment for your product to stand out. So the packaging itself, the process itself started along with the development of the product. So this is, it had a lot of components. And what we decided is something that will differentiate it would be like an asymmetric shape. And so we worked on a lot of iterations, and we came up with a design which although it looks a little asymmetrical, it is still unmistakably a tree. So even if you and we optimized it to a point where, you know, even if you reduce a little bit, it will not look like how it's supposed to look, or it will lose the tree-ness, you know. And so the brand managers and the owners loved the design so much that they used it as a promotional in their stores as well. In here you can see how, you know, the kids are interacting, and became like a point of sale solution as well. Okay, this is another, again, this is a very similar, another insight. So like I told you, like each gifting season, we come up with something new, right? So this was like for last year and this year is something which we did, which is the question was, what would actually make the packaging memorable, or what would actually add value to the product itself and to the whole experience? And this was like a pop-up pack which we did, and which is optimized to for larger volumes. And this is what we did for this Valentine's. Both are pop-up packs, very simple, as you can see. But again, there is like an element, something which you would want to retain. Okay. This is another project which we did for KitKat Desert Delight. So when this brief came to us, so KitKat was launching these truffle fingers. So each of these, they wanted to highlight every single truffle finger, because it was a little bit, it's more premium than your regular KitKat. And they wanted to add some sort of festivity to it. So as you can see, what we managed to squeeze in, you know, as a part of the design on the interior, and they were launching this for Diwali. So we managed to, you know, retain like a little bit of the swastika, you know, as you can see in the arrangement of the KitKats. And initially the brief was actually that we want each of these truffles to be suspended in air. So when you get that kind of a brief, you have to break it down, and how best can you achieve what the brand wants. And this was the solution. Okay, so I think we've come to the end of of the case studies that I wanted to show you. And hopefully you've learned something.
So I would request our audience to be participatory and ask any questions. Some of you already have done packaging design last semester, so anything you want to ask Nikhil, feel free.
Nikhil, I have a question for you.
Sure.
I'm thinking, in comparison to other regular studios.
Yeah.
Like Studio ABD or Future Factory, where so many, Lemon, Onion, I'm saying Onion. There's so many design studios. How is your functions different from them? Where do you have an edge for them? Where you think, you have competition from them?
Sure. So
also, that's okay. You can turn on your video so people can also see. Yeah.
Okay. So where we are different is basically we are very focused on a paper-based packaging design. So we are not even into molded pulp paper, so that even that is not something which we are into. So we are very focused, and a lot of times if you have no constraints, you tend to be all over the place. So for me, what I've realized, you know, even in the where I worked previously, what I've realized is if you center yourself around a certain constraint, then you can really push yourself and come up with something great, because there is a necessity for that to address any solution, but using the methods that you have at hand. So
correct.
That is something which we stick to, and to a large extent, you know, we face success doing that. And another advantage with our studio is that all those machines I spoke to you about, the whole process is just like is just joined to the studio, and we have. So that is something which immediately we can talk to the production and say we can, when we design something, we make sure that is something that we can make. For instance, you know, all these the projects that we've done for Nestle and KitKat and all these things, we make sure in such a way that you can make at least like, conservatively, at least like 80,000 of those in an hour. That requires a lot of that is something which probably other studios can also do it very well, but for us the process is a little bit smoother, because we are very much in touch with the production and the planning and the material and different processes.
So your business was more like backward integration. So you start, Parkson started as a manufacturing unit, and then they started design to accompany
product. Yes.
Okay. All right.
I had a question.
Yes, please.
I'm audible, right? Yeah.
Yes.
So I had to ask, given the pandemic, a lot of things have changed when it comes to e-commerce, like the market's increased and people who weren't usually into e-commerce have drifted to that sense. So do you think any packaging design as a whole has been changed in any way due to this pandemic? Like, has this changed any approach, something?
Sure. So if I were to understand correctly, you're saying that how we have adapted to this change?
Yeah, exactly. That's what I meant.
Okay. So if you've seen some, so even what we did, we actually designed face shields also. So because it was in the similar format of what we do. So we designed face shield, we designed face mask covers. So that was an immediate need which we had, right? And as for how is e-commerce changing? If I have to answer that, then I would say it is still evolving. We are not really sure that how is it going to change. Is the consumer pattern going to change in the long term, or is it something that is short term and reactionary? But yes, definitely there has been some movement in terms of people buying more things online, and we have received a little bit of requests for adapting a lot of their packs, which is and converted into more for e-commerce pack. So what would be the difference between like a normal pack and an e-commerce pack, if you say? So the first thing is the e-commerce pack has to be at least 3x more tougher, right? And for some products, it depends on the product segment, because it's a very wide array of segments that we have within the same product, within the same brand itself. So for say a brand which is selling like a product which is more day-to-day and which is cheap, I wouldn't say cheap is a wrong word, more cost effective that people use in day-to-day lives, for those kind of brands they would probably put more emphasis on on are they receiving like a genuine the genuine product itself? Because now you see counterfeiting is a huge problem in India, and how can the packaging address that? And when it comes to like more premium product, which you know people are used to going to a store to experience, how can they replicate the same experience in the packaging itself when you receive the packaging without, like, say, a nice environment or a salesperson to sell it? So then the packaging becomes the most important. It's your only, you know, it's the only brand messenger. It's the only face of your brand. So I think these are the focuses that people are doing. I hope that answers your question.
Yeah. Also, sir, lastly, I had to ask, like all of us heard, Apple removed their charger from their packaging recently. It opted out of it. So why do you think they did that? Was it a good approach, or do you think could have been the earlier thing was better? Your personal opinion on this.
My personal opinion. So I've been an Android person, you know. So for me, although I really, you know, appreciate, you know, the amount of thought and they put into design, and, you know, I've experienced the products, but the fact that they've removed it beats me. To be honest, it beats me. I still haven't understood the logic behind it. Although they say that it is streamlined their, you know, their product wastage and, you know, their packaging wastage. To be honest, for me, like personally, if I buy a new phone, ideally I would like a new charger as well.
Okay, sir. Okay.
So I had a question in continuation to the last topic.
Sure.
So, sir.
Anvika, and others also, please turn on your video. Otherwise, it looks like, you know, ghosts are coming.
I think it takes a minute to come live. Okay. So, sir, how has you know, brand? How are brands responding to the fact that a lot of news and a lot of research was coming about cardboard or paper having the virus for 3 hours or 24 hours, and mostly people are throwing these cartons outside and just bringing the product inside their house. So, in that sense, how have brands reacted to the pandemic, and how has, you know, your process changed, and what trends will we be seeing for packaging which is more, you know, hygienic or more mindful for the people?
Okay, so when I'm talking about so packaging is already very conscious when it comes, because for the brand the product matters more, you know, obviously. Mm-hmm. Right. So the packaging is something which is really important to them, but the trend I see is people still moving towards sustainable packaging and to become more conscious of, you know, waste. And because of this pandemic, I'm sure that definitely, you know, people are, so for instance, if there are, if something which we had done manually, there are some processes, so for instance, which we had done manually. So now we are more conscious that even the brands are more conscious, they ask. So they are saying that, we want something which is, it's okay, we might compromise a little bit on the experience, but we would like something which is more automated and passes through fewer hands.
Okay.
Right. So then the solutions which provide both, which is more, provides a good experience and automated. So that is something which they are looking for.
I mean, are there any trends coming in the material segment as well, like because I mean, if I look at like even any product that comes either online or through a grocery seller, I mean, I know like a paper or a cardboard of different GSM would have a different cost altogether, and right now it's not solving the purpose of selling me any information because it's not coming inside my house.
So
is there any innovation that, or are companies taking different approach to the material as well?
Okay, so if you look for say single plastics which are being used, so that's a huge quantum which other manufacturers will have to fill. So what I see is not a single solution can solve that. Say for instance, we got an opportunity in Maggi to reduce those plastic inserts, multiple trays in plastic, we got to reduce that. So I'm not saying paper is the only solution, but if you've seen recent trends, people have come up with paper which has more barrier properties, which they can directly fill liquid in. There are bioplastics, they need to be more scalable. I think not one single solution will address the whole, the whole quantum of solution that is needed, but you'll need multiple different processes and specific to the need that they're trying to address and the cost that the consumer can bear according to each brand. So I think that is what is win.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Hello, sir.
Hi.
So my question to you is, in your talk, as you mentioned that when we get any kind of delivery from Amazon, we have a lot of waste packaging around the main packaging of the product. Now, I read a case study regarding a startup in the US where they were manufacturing, custom boxes, which can be returned back to the company who are delivering. And because of the success of this this system, there were even pizza delivery system companies started using this system where the pizza is delivered in a custom box and the user can move the pizza and return the box back. Now this process, obviously reduces a lot of wastage in terms of material. Now I wanted to know what your opinion is about how this kind of system where you're reducing a huge amount of material, it could be sustainable material, but at the end of the day, even to make paper pulp, you need to cut down trees, right? So even if they can be recycled. So how do you think such systems could be implemented in brick and mortar stores where a person would be actually going and buying products?
Okay. So coming to the first part of your question, which you're talking about returnable packaging. So it has, even Amazon has tried to do it. So what I think is it's a good initiative. And if it's something, it depends on how they're managing to collect the packaging back. Because if you're talking about something which I use the box and then give it back, It probably increases the strain on the logistics, right? So for example, if you buy something on Amazon and you return it, so you're actually, the guy who's actually trying to get you is spending more fuel coming back to you. So in that case, that could probably solve by a simple thing like product segregation, which is, I think they are already implemented or being implemented in tier one and tier two cities. And that is something at a process level needs to be addressed. Definitely, packaging plays a big role there. For example, reducing plastics wherever we can counts, whatever percentage we can counts, and making recyclability easy, that definitely plays a role. So for instance, now even in paper, we have a lot of eco-friendly inks, which you can dispose of. And, there are alternatives for lamination, plastic lamination. There are more eco-friendly alternatives for that. So things have come out, they have to scale up more. And so that is what I think about, the question you asked for something which is recyclable. And as for paper, if you see, it still has a lot of recyclability because the more you buy recycled paper, the more it stays in circulation, right? And this, it's still, you can dispose it. It's not that. And as for producing the papers, effort should be made more to buy from, you know, there are standards in which they maintain sustainable growth of trees. You know, only you make paper only from those. So I think those these two are probably are the solutions.
Right.
Sir, I also saw Jio in one of your clients, the list that you showed us.
Yeah.
So I would want to ask, what did you all do for Jio? Like, which packaging did you?
For Jio, we have made some. We had made some cell phone packaging some time back, and for their. We had made boxes for some of their, I think we had made, it was like a little bit long time back, and we had made something for their routers, I think. I'll have to check.
Okay, that would be awesome. Thank you.
So Nikhil, I had another question.
Sure.
Sorry, Prakash. Okay, go, Prakash, go ahead first.
Hello, sir. Actually, I wanted to ask that how is packaging designing design is different than product design? As we are a product designer, we started seeing these are two different industries or these different fields. So, and what are the key points or parameters we should consider while designing a packaging? Like we consider while designing products. So okay. I believe there is some difference, and how they are differ from each other, yes.
To be honest, as far as I'm concerned, so the design process remains the same, right? How you identify problems and how you crystallize them into a good solution, which the end user, it really affects the end user. So the process remains the same, but there are a little bit of nuances, like you probably worry more about how of the logistics part, you know, how they are going to ship it. There are more stakeholders involved. The cost is more, the cost versus the value argument here is more aggressive. Right. And generally, when it comes to services like us, it's more like a lot of times we have to think indirectly about the end consumer, but not directly. Whereas in product, you directly have to think about the end consumer. Right. So that is probably the little bit of nuance that you find when you're designing packaging. But as for the design process and everything is concerned, of how you the design methodology and how you crystallize it into insights and bring up with solutions and sketches, 3D models, mockups, all of that remains the same. Testing, prototyping. In fact, you know, I feel like across fields it's very similar.
Yes. Okay, thank you.
Hello.
Hello, yeah.
Yeah, this is Rishabh. I had a question about some of the more playful kinds of packages that you'll do. Yeah. So the big question is that, like, you know, whenever we come up with some sort of idea that could, you know, be playful or interesting to the user, there's always that big question as to, you know, over a decent period of years, will the consumers, you know, still, you know, find that that type of package, you know, attractive? Will it still be playful? Like, how long will a package that is supposed to be retained with the consumer actually be retained before it's thrown away? So okay. How do you all go about looking at that?
You know, it's ideal to design something that, you know, that always design something that lasts the test of time, you know. If you look at all the, you know, classic designs, you know, but I think it's always important to always redesign it in the context. So every 5 to 10 years, the whole context changes, right? What the audience is used to and how they get jaded. So for instance, something which I call extremely interactive in the 1960s or 70s would probably not be the same, because the next generation already seen growing that up. But at the same time, I can look to the past for inspiration and repackage something and do something so that it appeals to the audience that is there right now. So in that context, your design remains more or less, because every generation needs that, right? That kind of interaction. So when you repackage it, that is where it retains that value. And I personally think if it's, especially at the pace at which technology is growing right now, it's unprecedented what you probably thought was, say, 30 years back or, 40 years back, at the rate at which it's growing. I think it would be interesting to always design something that is more contextual.
Okay. All right. So that
for example, the Rubik's Cube, right? So that's a classic.
Yeah.
But if you go to the toy stores, you will find like there are like a plethora of options other than the Rubik's Cube. There are tetrahedron shapes, which are also Rubik cubes. So people are built on top of that. So.
Okay. So let's say whenever the context change, like over a period of years, when some sort of new trends come in, say you had some package which is to be retained by the consumer, like the Rubik's Cube that you were talking about. As such, it won't be retained by the consumer forever, right? So it'll still go as waste.
Of course, it has to, right? New things have to come.
Yeah.
Of course, you'll try your best to retain it, but at a certain point, you will of course dispose of it, right?
Right.
It wears out.
Yeah. Okay. So, do you need to take that into consideration also? Like, it's going to be disposed of in some time. So, is it, eco-friendly or biodegradable in that sense?
Of course. Yeah, of course.
All right. Okay. Yeah. Thank
you. So, because how long are you going to play with the Rubik's Cube? There'll be a phase, but each one of us will go through that phases at a different point of time, so it'll always be relevant. At the same time, it will not be that relevant.
Right, so
that is the extent which we can go in case in if you're talking about this particular case, that is the kind of extent which you can go.
All right, got it. Yeah, thank you.
Incidentally, I also conduct the packaging design course. So,
okay, nice.
Yeah. So, to answer Rishab Nagkarni's question, I was also thinking, whenever I meet these people, I tell them, how do you create a market differentiator, right?
Yeah.
When people go to a retail store, whether it's a mall or any place, and they see on the shelf, so how does your packaging stand out? And second thing is a recall value with providing a playful interaction is one thing, is to slightly extend the life of the packaging and adding a value to that cardboard box beyond just packaging, but to give for even a week's time or 2-3 days of play, playing with it. And with that interaction, you kind of bring a closer connect to the customer for a recall value.
Yeah.
The more time you spend. That's what I think.
And it's something. It's also about creating memories. So I remember when I was a kid, in this Lay's, PepsiCo Lay's packet, you used to get Tazos. So Tazos are long gone, but the idea of that module and how I played with it that experience remains with me. So, so like and you said, so yeah, the memory remains, right? So that is something which in which they've successfully addressed the need.
Correct. It's also with gold spot. You know, you remember this gold spot?
Yeah.
So yes. We had in the top metal cap. Top. There was during those days cricket was not so regular. I think not like T20. So we used to collect those things from the cap. There used to be always one cartoon, and we had a series of them. So in a way, it is it's making some kind of brand loyalty connect with the user, so you will stick around for a longer time.
And associating, so like the smarter brands, what they do is they realize that making memories is important for the end consumer. So that's what the end consumer cares about. So if you can somehow make your brand a part of that memory, or create that kind of impact, so that is what would be ideal for the brand, right? So even if you see liquor brands, they talk, for example, Royal Stag, they're talking all about number one yari, and the whole thing revolves around friendship and how you spend time along with the products. So I think that is applicable.
The way I see it is also packaging is one thing, is it has one function of protecting, but a main function of packaging is marketing. Actually, it falls in marketing, right? So this way, I think with the playful packages, packaging designs that you showed us today, perhaps serve a better marketing function. I have one question to you, Nikhil, was about bagasse, because you said fiber-based and paper-based packaging.
Yeah.
So, the last 2-3 years, I have been seeing this bagasse is used for, the plates and bowls and things like that. In some areas, it has been used for packaging. So, how do you see the future of bagasse? Because it's a very eco-friendly material. But I'm sure it has its limitations, or you can't print on it and things like that.
So for me, that's what I see, is like the whole ecosystem has changed. For example, like if you take electric cars, right? So it's not enough to make only electric cars. You need to introduce subsidies. You need to introduce it in at a reasonable cost. You need to introduce a good electric charging network for that, then only it makes sense. So similarly, there are a lot of these solutions which are great. I think I personally love these kind of solutions, and especially bagasse. But for a business like ours, we have to make sure that something that actually doesn't, something that fits into a machine. For example, we have these folding and gluing machines. Instance, when say for example, when your papers goes through platform, there are arms that lift and fold it, and that is how you place the boxes. So so it has to go through a lot of those technologies also have to evolve to actually suit that, and that will only happen if there is more demand for that. So let's hope for the best that it does.
Okay. Right. So anyone has a question or any point to discuss? Shobhik and Sagar, you have anything to say?
No, I think all the points have been covered. So it was really great. Yeah. Thanks.
Okay. Yeah, Rishabh is saying something. Yes, please, Rishabh.
Oh no, I forgot to lower my hand. I'm sorry.
Okay. So if we are done, then more or less, I would like to thank our guest, Nikhil, again.
I know that he had a busy schedule, but he managed to squeeze out time for us. I really appreciate that, Nikhil. And through the few case studies that you showed us, you know, our minds have opened up to being creative at packaging, and yet be, you know, cost effective, affordable, and make sense to the marketing team. So
I would say, as a student, when I passed out, you know, I used to fight the constraints. I would suggest, like, you embrace the constraints and you'll come up with good solutions.
okay, good. Yeah, so thanks a lot again, Nikhil. And thank you, everybody, for joining me today. And we hope to see you next Saturday. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
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 Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.